Breaking news tonight, the coronavirus forcing millions more Americans into virtual lockdown.
Not everyone is dying from the coronavirus.
It's always you, coronavirus.
Coronavirus in the fall.
New information about this novel coronavirus.
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 The coronavirus.
Coronavirus.
Corona.
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 In early March of 2020, when many college students were on spring break, enjoying a much-needed vacation, the reality and danger of the novel coronavirus, COVID-19, did not sink in at first. They were on spring break. They didn't think they'd be impacted.
Here I go again!
Until they were. Until the emails arrived announcing that colleges were moving online. And then our college, the University of Virginia, said don't return. Stay home after spring break. And then, collectively, from the height of the joys of spring break and spring itself, they were overnight returning to a life or death crisis. Then when we returned home, we were tracking the news. News about rising death rates. News about the safety imperative to actually sit at home. News about the falling economy. College students in America were not just moving class online. We were losing jobs.
It's unfortunate to lose a job before you even start.
Athletic seasons.
Everybody just starts to cry.
And family togetherness.
There's just this little barrier between us.
And then 2 months away, almost to the day, came word we were losing graduation itself.
My first response was definitely just like crushing disappointment.
That's when we, the Basic Multimedia Reporting class at the University of Virginia, saw this as the story of our lives. We asked our professor to throw out the rest of the syllabus to allow us to cover this moment in history as a documentary. When he said yes, we found these stories and assembled them remotely using our laptops and our phones. And now, from two continents and four states, this is who we are.
My name is Heather Thomas, and I'm quarantined in Charlottesville, Virginia.
Hi, my name is Katie.
Hi, my name is Dylan Terman.
Hi, my name is Karen Kern, and I'm reporting from Northern Virginia.
Hi, my name is Jack Mulquin.
I'm Sarah Del Coco.
Hi, my name is Meryl Carlton, and I'm quarantining in Miami, Florida.
My name's Sierra Ruiz, and I'm quarantined in Houston, Texas.
Mackenzie, and I'm in Seattle, Washington during quarantine.
I'm Jamie Bullock, and I am in Johannesburg, South Africa.
This is Spring Broken, College on COVID. While the crisis forced sudden moves and lifestyle changes on every college student, no one felt the sense of whiplash more than college athletes. UVA has more than 700 collegiate athletes, and with the loss of their athletic seasons, our men's basketball, men's lacrosse, and women's rowing lost their chance of defending their championships. One of our classmates, Jamie Bullock, a starter on the women's rowing team, had finished a workout on March 12th when word came the season was canceled. She was jolted in an instant from her life as a D1 athlete in her prime to a plane ticket and then the inside of her home in Johannesburg, South Africa.
In early March, I was at the heart of my rowing season, training every day with my teammates, all of us focused on winning our 11th straight ACC title. Within a week, however, the NCAA shut down all spring sports for the year due to COVID-19, and UVA classes were to be moved online. For me, this meant returning to South Africa for the foreseeable future. Many of us are still in shock, unsure how to live our everyday lives without the purpose of training, without being a part of a team. Third year, Abby Bird and I had just finished an intense workout preparing for our first regatta of the season when we were called to a team meeting with head coach Kevin Sauer. We all suspected that the virus might change our schedules, but neither Abby nor I had any idea the entire season and our time together was being cut short.
Everybody just started to cry and you could literally feel the heartbreak outside as we were all kind of like looking at each other and kind of like realizing that some people we probably weren't ever going to see again, and like we're never going to race as that boat again and stuff. And I wouldn't want any athlete to ever feel like that ever again, because it was such a horrible position to be in.
As I flew home to South Africa and Abby to Maidenhead, England, west of London, it finally sunk in. We had left UVA, left America, and left our friends. A
And every day, the isolation reminded us of what we were supposed to be achieving.
I just really miss being back at school. I'm a big person on social media, so I have a lot of Snapchat memories. And it's the Snapchat memories that are coming up from last year that are just constant reminders of what we would normally be doing rather than being stuck at home. See, I don't think there was ever a point where I didn't think it was serious. Mm-hmm. Like I've definitely been aware of it for the whole time. But I do remember a moment when I was in bed at the beginning of spring break after practice, and I was all on my own, and I just suddenly started crying because I had no control over what was going on. The scary part was thinking that, oh, like, I'm actually going to have to go home soon.
As a student and a collegiate athlete, Abby is juggling multiple concerns during this time.
I think the biggest worry is the fact that I have no idea when I can go back. Mm-hmm. I really miss the team. But I've also left two homes back in Charlottesville. I packed most of my apartment up before I left. But there are still a few things in there. Like I share my apartment with two other girls and the lease is going to run out soon and I'm in another country. So I have no idea what to do about something that's happening in like 3 months' time. I'm also really worried about the idea of my fourth year starting online. Yeah. I really don't want that to happen.
As the college athletes were being sent home and made fully aware of the pandemic, life was still blissful for college students on spring break, who were on a mission to remain carefree. And even for students who were watching the news, the message they heard was, no problem.
When news first started to break that COVID-19 had reached the United States, it was only 2 days before schools like UVA's spring breaks began. While many people did not yet understand the significance of this virus at the time, the media started to paint young people who were continuing on with their spring breaks in a bad light.
A CBS video went viral after they interviewed some of the Miami spring breakers.
If I get corona, I get corona. At the end of the day, I'm not going to let it stop me from partying.
I was actually in Miami for spring break visiting my boyfriend's family who lives there, and we were really excited to meet up with our friends on the beach. And that day, rumors were circulating that classes might be moved online, but I wasn't really stressing about it because I was on break and I didn't want to think about school.
Joey Blunt, a third-year football player at the University of Virginia, had gone to Central Beach in Fort Lauderdale before any stay-at-home orders were put in place. He was already 4 days into his vacation when his semester was moved online, and he found himself surrounded by thousands of other misinformed or unknowing college students.
The beaches were was a madhouse. People were stacked on top of each other, shoulder to shoulder. People were creating like, it looked like a barge of people in the water on the sandbars, just wrestling and music. People were stepping on each other's towels. You don't know what was going on. People were touching, breathing on each other. It was a madhouse.
Joey's teammate, third year Mandy Alonzo, returned home to Miami for spring break. The news that he wouldn't be able to return to the university for football workouts or class had not fully sunk in yet, as there was still a lot of confusion among Americans regarding the virus.
So that day, I mean, nobody really cared about the virus. Nobody, I think, knew like the actual effects of it. So everybody was living their normal lives, and it was basically a normal day on the beach.
I was like thinking, like, dang, this is crazy, but I haven't been like paying attention a lot to the news. And I already knew from people just telling me and what I've seen that it wasn't really happening to younger people. That it was more elderly or just had onset of like prior health issues. So I really wasn't worried about if I was younger. I'm young, fit, I feel good, not really sick, so. That was just a little cold.
And yeah, that day, the police actually ended up driving everybody off the beach on horses. But like, what were people supposed to do? They already had hotel reservations and flights, and it just wasn't realistic for everybody to just get up and go home. And so, yeah, I actually canceled my flight at the end of the week, and I have been in Miami ever since. I don't know when it will be safe to go home. I don't know when I'm gonna see my parents again. But yeah, it seems like every time they say that this situation is about to get better, it just gets worse.
For the graduating class of 2020, COVID-19 robbed them of more than just their last semester of classes and lifelong memories. For these soon-to-be graduates, the announcement canceling or postponing graduation diminished their sense of validation, their identity, and their idea of how a college career is supposed to end.
For college seniors, the final lap, the semester of lasts, celebrations, and the ceremony marking the end of it all, is a reward for 4 years of unrelenting effort.
Katie Cantone, a fourth year in her last semester at the University of Virginia, found herself mourning the profound loss of this highly anticipated time of triumph.
My first response was definitely just like crushing disappointment. It was like so many milestones, and like there's so much expectation built into that final 6 weeks where it's like you've been working so hard and that's supposed to be the culmination of like your college experience. It's like every hour of every day is like precious and you're supposed to cling to it, and then it's just like yanked away.
For many, the pain of the announcement was accompanied by a sense of denial and disconnection. For UVA fourth year Zoe Patau, news of canceled graduation upended not only plans, but her sense of self.
I'm definitely very proud of like what I've accomplished over the past 4 years, but I think it's difficult to not come like have some form of closure with all these like major parts of my identity, and not having like sort of like events to get closure and commiserate that. Like, it doesn't really feel real to me right now.
Ibtissam Amin, another UVA fourth year, found it difficult to let go of the symbolic meaning attached to this rite of passage.
The idea of having this like one joyous event where like my friends would be there and my family would come down, I think that is something that all fourth years were kind of like clinging on to, and it's like the one thing that you're kind of promised in college, because everything is so unexpected. I don't think it ever hit me like how personal it would feel, and like how like personally invested I was in like seeing the rest of this semester through and like having graduation. But I have like struggled with my mental health a lot, and I have like had a lot of like lows, and I think graduating and like kind of the end of this chapter and like the excitement and like the possibility of like the future and like hope and all of that stuff was like really what was like getting me through.
As the initial shock of postponement subsided and a tentative graduation date has been set for fall of 2020, disappointment and unfulfillment have given way to a sense of achievement.
This is like the ultimate testament to seeing like how comfortable you are with like changing a part of your life for the benefit of somebody else. It's made me weirdly realize like how much I should just be thankful for the fact that like I had like the 3¾ years, because like even though it sucks to not have like an event to celebrate that, what the event is celebrating is still there and like always will be.
Many of the graduating fourth years quickly came to realize that the loss of that ceremony and celebration was about to be overshadowed by the loss of their post-grad jobs.
It's unfortunate to lose a job before you even start.
University of Virginia student Daniel Crystal is just one of thousands of graduating fourth years struggling to reclaim a post-grad job after the offer he secured in information services after his internship last summer was suddenly taken away due to the virus.
The end of March, we just heard that our offers were all rescinded. This is across the board, so all new hires across the entire company, which is probably at least 200 to 300 people.
To keep himself busy, Daniel has been scouring the job market to find sustainable work for after graduation. He has tried to keep a positive attitude in his attempt to enter the current collapsing economy, but the overnight nature of this disastrous event has left him clueless.
So I had not been thinking about recruiting or anything like that. I've tried to make the best of it. I've been doing what I usually do, just applying to a ton of jobs, reaching out to my network. It's just the roles I most wanted are pretty much finished hiring. They've already gone through their cycles. So it might be a little while before the roles I'm more specifically interested in open up again.
Daniel had his job secured before COVID-19 changed his life,
However, the pandemic has made it impossible for some graduating college students to find any post-grad work opportunities.
UVA fourth year Kristen Bollinger thought she could find a job in finance after college, just like many of her peers in the McIntyre School of Commerce. She was let down to learn that most companies are not even considering hiring anymore.
I had an interview for a company right before I left for spring break, and I didn't really hear back from them until after spring break, and I thought it went really well. And when I got back, they contacted me and like reassured me that I did do well, which was nice to hear, but they were kind of stopping hiring at the time. It's just been hard because I think a lot of companies don't know what their next 6 months or even a year is going to look like. So for them to start hiring entry-level like people is kind of a risk that they don't want to take.
Rather than focus solely on how discouraging her current job situation is, Kristen has chosen to take solace in the fact that she is not alone.
I know that a lot of people are in the same boat as me, which is kind of sad, but also like comforting to hear.
Because of the slowing economy, almost every college student has by now lost a promised internship or part-time jobs they needed to help pay for school. 8 out of 10 college students in America have to work, sometimes 2 jobs to pay expenses or their tuition bill. And most of these students were not on spring break. Most were working until the sun began to set on them too.
Junior Susan Lee, a server at the Virginian in Charlottesville, lost her job after Virginia Governor Ralph Northam barred all dine-in restaurant services in order to facilitate social distancing.
A few days like after when students would have came back to UVA, that's when they announced that they're actually closing like the Virginian, and that we wouldn't be offering any services, so like no to-go or anything like that. And then all the employees were told that they were laid off.
Losing her job was difficult because she needed the money to pay for groceries, sorority dues, and other bills. Since she's now out of work, her parents have had to take on her financial burden during one of the worst economic crashes in history.
In a few months, my auto insurance will renew, so they said they will pay for my car insurance as well as like my car taxes that will be soon because I'm not making any money.
After losing her only source of income, Susan attempted to file for unemployment but was frustrated by the outdated system.
I was going to file for it. I just haven't yet because I started once and I like incorrectly did something and I tried to go back to fix it, but the system wouldn't change it because it's like really old, and it was also really slow. Like I'm assuming so many other people in Virginia are like filing for unemployment too, so the website was really slow and I couldn't change like one thing that I did wrong, so I have to start over. I just haven't.
When Congress passed a $2 trillion stimulus package, Susan hoped she would be receiving $1,200, but in the fine print, young adults who were still on their parents' taxes as dependents were not included.
It just sucks that, like, I know, like, a lot of, like, my peers and I, like, won't qualify for it, even though we've been laid off.
New Jersey resident Stephen Malazzi felt frustrated after he lost out on several job opportunities due to coronavirus.
I have lost 5 jobs in the course of just about a month because of this coronavirus, 4 of which happened in just 4 days.
Upon returning home from UVA to finish his semester online, Stephen got a job delivering pizzas for Domino's. Once he had been driving for a little over a month, he made the decision to leave.
3 days after I quit, it came out that one of the employees had gotten diagnosed with coronavirus, which is why I'm currently in self-quarantine right now, because that coronavirus guy might have given it to me and I wouldn't know. And I am quarantined because my parents are at huge risk because of this coronavirus. They have, each one of them has an issue. My dad has compromised lungs. My mom has a heart condition that puts them at huge risk for coronavirus and could really damage them if they were to contract it. So I've been locked in my room by myself, alone, for like 9 days. And it's getting to me. It sucks. It's terrible.
In just a few weeks, Stephen went from class in Charlottesville to what felt like jail, all in the name of safety.
My parents bring my food up to me on like a on a prison-like tray. And I eat my meals in my room by myself on my bed, which I'm currently sitting on because that's the only place I have to sit in my room as well.
Stephen is taking his quarantine seriously to keep his family safe. In addition to his meal delivery system, he and his parents have coordinated a way for him to try and feel a little more normal.
It's totally brutal, and I get to leave the house about once a day. That's to go outside. My mom opens the front door for me. I run out. My shoes aren't even in the house. They're in the garage. I grab them every time I go outside, and then I go for a drive for about an hour, and that's basically all the outside time I get. And if you think it can't happen to you, know that it really can. This isn't isolated to people. You're not invincible. No one is. Only work if you have to work. Only if it's essential. I mean, I was negligent to that, and by the time I realized it, it was too late. You just gotta be careful. Nothing's worth the safety of your family.
While we were conducting these interviews, the UVA hospital was working on overdrive each day, treating between 10 and 20 COVID patients. For the more than 1,300 UVA nursing and medical students, classes were not entirely online, and their choice to join a risky profession got dangerously real.
I would say the first thing I think about is my patients.
Third year, Maddie Mansour is one of thousands of nursing students across the country working on the front line. She works in the pediatrics department at the UVA Medical Center. And because the virus might circulate anywhere in the hospital, Maddie feels responsible for keeping it away from her vulnerable patients.
I've been working full-time at the hospital, mostly night shifts. And I decided to pick up more hours because I have more time now. I'm not really concerned necessarily about myself, but for my other patients that might be like immunocompromised, or, you know, it's a very vulnerable population, kids, and if they already have like a lessened immune system, it's scary, like the thought of if I pass it on to one of them, I would never be able to like forgive myself for doing that. So it's kind of, it's surreal and kind of scary to think that there's this, you know, this huge pandemic going on and you're kind of at the front of all of it. Just thinking about and hearing about, you know, these patients that are alone and their families aren't even allowed to see them. It's just really, really sad to think that, you know, one minute your family member was fine and now you can't even say goodbye to them.
Although Mansour doesn't work directly with patients infected by the coronavirus, since UVA has confirmed over 20 COVID patients from the start of the outbreak, and hospitals don't always know who has the virus, every worker has to presume that they are at risk of close contact.
They're having meetings daily to try to come up with policies that you know, protect both the patients and the staff at the university. When you walk in the hospital, you get a like brown paper bag with a mask, and that's the one mask that you have to use through the whole week. And you have to use the same goggles too. So you have to be wearing goggles and a mask at all times, like all throughout your 12-hour shift.
As she and her coworkers help in the fight against COVID-19, Mansour says this pandemic has only made her passion to help others that much stronger.
This experience has really affirmed the fact that I do want to go into the medical profession and kind of realize how important, you know, it is to be working and to be a part of a team that's fighting for the same cause. Just seeing, you know, the difference that we really can make has been really, you know, affirming to say, okay, this is what I want to do with the rest of my life.
The risk of death in this pandemic remains low for most healthy people in their 20s, but some UVA students are at extreme risk because of underlying diseases. They see themselves as the living reasons for home isolation and remain afraid that someone nearby will make a mistake.
Hannah Hardiman is a third-year student at the University of Virginia. She appears perfectly healthy, but both her and her father suffer from Crohn's disease, which leaves them much more vulnerable to sickness than the general population.
What were your initial feelings when you first realized that the coronavirus situation was getting serious?
First, I was like kind of scared, and then I was really mad.
I'm immunocompromised and my dad is also immunocompromised. We're at high risk for getting complications. And I felt like people were being really selfish and only thinking about what would be best for them and not would be best for the community as a whole. I feel so bad for my mom because to go to the grocery store, she has like mask on, gloves on, sunglasses, full battle gear on, like completely covered. But then when she gets back from the grocery store, she has to wash everything.
Hannah is worried and angry that her peers may not realize the gravity of the virus.
People are literally dying and like your first thought is, oh, I can go hang out with my friends.
Third-year UVA student Amelia Lindsay was studying abroad in Spain, one of the epicenters of the virus,
and was severely concerned not only for her semester, but for her own health.
I was terrified because I was living in Spain. The numbers started doubling in Spain overnight, and pretty much within a week, we realized we were all getting sent home, and it was really, really sad and horrible.
The thought of traveling home amidst crowded airports and planes left her riddled with anxiety.
I have reactive airway disease, which is pretty much the same thing as asthma. And it means that when I get sick, it becomes really hard to breathe. And the people with coronavirus who were healthy have a hard time breathing. And I have a hard time breathing when I get a cold. So I know that if I got coronavirus, I would likely be hospitalized.
Amelia described her new normal, which is staying in her father's empty condo with only occasional visits from her family. The careless actions of some of her peers continue to enrage and frighten her.
There are people that are being completely irresponsible, going to beaches and things like that.
Yeah.
How does that make you feel?
It is wildly frustrating, I think, for all of us who are practicing social distancing to see people still hanging out at each other's houses. It is really frustrating. To see people not respecting the rules, especially because it affects all of us.
For some, the idea of returning home wasn't so terrible. Home meant a safe place to be taken care of and a sense of stability. But for others, life is complicated. They return to epicenters of the disease and loving yet fractured families in conflict over what to do.
When I came home from school in March, it quickly became clear that the existing divisions within my family had only deepened since the coronavirus took hold. Our parents have been divorced for over a decade, but since the quarantine started, my sister and I, for the first time, have been physically separated from each other as well. My mom and sister are quarantining in the suburbs about an hour away, while my dad and I remain here in the city. We've been separated since my dad accused my sister of violating social distancing measures. Even though it turned out that my sister had likely contracted COVID-19 at one point, she still blames my dad for the split.
I'm still really angry about it. It was not justified. The way I kind of put it in my head is if a child is sick with a chicken pox, they will most likely infect the people around them. But that does not mean you put your child outside on the doorstep. But it really feels like that's what's happening to me. And I don't even have, at that time, I did not have any symptoms of any virus of any sort.
But everything came to a head when my sister decided to go out with her friends and violate social distancing measures. My dad had told her beforehand that if she went, she wouldn't be able to come over again for 2 weeks until she'd quarantined for that period of time and not displayed any symptoms. However, the next day she posted a picture on Instagram of herself with her friends. Megan and my mom also feel frustrated because they believe that they've been cast as the unclean and unruly half of the family since the start of the pandemic. We only found out at the end of those 2 weeks, when we asked my sister to come back, that she and my mom had both been displaying symptoms of COVID-19 for some time.
Was it hard not telling me about that?
Yeah, it was hard, and it felt like I couldn't share a lot of my life with you because it revolves around the virus, obviously, because we're all in quarantine. So I think that added to the broken relationship. So that's been hard. And it's like, I don't want to tell anyone because then I'm categorized as the sick one and I don't want to be that.
It seems that the quarantine has only amplified the divisions that already existed within our family, with Megan and my mom on one side and my dad and I on the other.
Unexpected problems continued to arise as the effects of the virus spread beyond immediate family. Extended family members face their own set of challenges. One of our producers, Jack Mulquin, is extremely close to his grandmother, Nana, and can no longer visit her. This separation has taken a large toll on him and his family. She has her own underlying conditions, making her more vulnerable to the virus. But for the rest of the Mulquins, it isn't COVID-19 they fear.
We miss you.
Nana, can you see me?
So much. I love you.
Coming home for spring break, I was looking forward to spending time with my Nana, who has Alzheimer's. She was supposed to move in with us, but due to the COVID-19 pandemic, that plan has changed. My father is an essential worker at a local university, and we are worried that we could unnecessarily put my Nana at risk. Sadly, my Nana doesn't understand why she can't come live with us, or why we can't give her a hug. Now we are concerned we will miss out on our opportunity because we're worried her dementia will advance without that constant interaction between our family.
My brother, Will Mulquin, is sophomore at Catholic University of America, never imagined balancing his classwork with concern for his grandparents' health. Our Nana has lived with Alzheimer's for 10 years and lived with us in the early stages of her disease. Before her memory declined and she moved to assisted living, she was an integral part of our family. She taught Will how to read and was a constant supporter at his sporting events. To Will, Alzheimer's and COVID-19 changes the way she needs to be loved.
My Nana, we can't communicate with her unless we go to the window because she has Alzheimer's. We go outside her house and wave to her through the window. So recently she started talking again, and that was kind of disappointing. We couldn't go and kind of have a formal conversation with her.
My family worries constantly about Nana's quality of life. Our family makes a big deal of reminding her who she is and who she was. As time passes, the lack of physical connection and constant reminder of what she means to us, we wonder if the bond will ever be the same.
Being at home, it's kind of stressful having to learn, take classes, while also worrying about whether your grandparents are going to survive this coronavirus.
The moment I stepped out of my car to visit my Nana at her assisted living home was surreal. She was sitting in her wheelchair on her side porch and with a big grin on her face, and she was just waving to me, and I was just overwhelmed by that action of love when she blew me a kiss. It's really hard, like, not being able to go give her a hug. It breaks my heart.
Despite the crushing effects of the COVID-19 pandemic, some students have taken it upon themselves to find new outlets for spreading positivity and staying connected. Whether through inspirational music or through the creation of artistic projects, students tried to cope as best they could.
Joey Michael, a first-year student at the University of Virginia School of Medicine, had the song Don't Start Now by Dua Lipa on repeat in his playlist. And then, as the coronavirus pandemic unfolded, he decided, why not rewrite the lyrics as a safety message on staying protected against the virus? Did a 4180, Donnie, you said it wasn't gonna be bad. Joey says replacing the words to Don't Start Now came to him in a light bulb moment.
I think right when kind of the term social distancing started being used kind of in the mainstream, the lyrics like don't show up, don't come out, like they match.
After his rewrite, Joey thought bigger. He got his friend Sam Roller, a UVA alumnus who is now a music producer, to create a video with the music tracking his lyrics on screen. That's when Joey wondered, why not ask everyone to dance to this?
And so I kind of asked my classmates, I sent a mass email to the entire medical school, which wow. Do not recommend from a first year medical student. So I sent out an email to like 600 people who had, you know, probably only a quarter of them knew who I was, and kind of said, I threw this together, please send in video submissions for a music video during the verse. I just want to see, what are you doing in quarantine? Are you knitting? Are you exercising? Are you doing yoga? Are you watching Netflix? Like, give me a taste of what's going on.
Sure enough, 13 of his fellow med students took the time not just to understand what he wanted, they got into it.
It's a popular song, it gives a good message, and it makes you feel a little better about what's going on. I think for me, it was like the goal was initially to just complete a project and to do something fun and creative and something that would rally the medical school like students together and do something as one, though separated by distance.
If students weren't creating projects to cope with the emotional toll of COVID-19, they were forging new relationships with man's best friend. Across the country, animal shelters were emptied at a record speed as students and most of the country sought out comfort, companionship, and canine roommates.
Hi, my name is Dylan Terman, and I'm currently quarantined here in Charlottesville, Virginia. I wasn't able to return to my home in southwestern Virginia due to my immunocompromised grandfather, so I decided to stay at my home near UVA. I knew pretty early on that I was interested in fostering a dog, so I filled out an application through the Charlottesville Albemarle SPCA, and I quickly heard back from them to schedule an appointment. On the application, I put my first choice as Ivy, because she looked really cute and she reminded me a little bit of Scooby-Doo with the blue collar that she had on.
In mid-March, the Charlottesville ASPCA began to prepare for a shelter-in-place order. They implemented a drive-through adoption and foster pickup system, which made the process super seamless and easy. Foster coordinator Morgan Struble has been astounded by the community's response to the shelter during this time.
Today was spectacular. We had 62 animals leave for foster care. We've had 96 leave since Saturday. So our courtyard, which is usually really loud, you can only hear a few dogs barking because that's really all that's here.
It's been really nice having Ivy around thus far. Making sure that I take her out for walks throughout the day and get her food and water at the right times helps add some structure to my day during the quarantine when it's really tempting to just lay around in bed and not get anything done.
However, taking care of dogs isn't easy, and Ivy has really bad separation anxiety. Ivy wasn't going to make sense for me to have long term, especially since I have no clue where I'm going to be next year without having a full-time job lined up currently and with the coronavirus going on.
Caitlin Reed and her fiancé Cameron have been hoping to get a dog since they moved to Charlottesville from Utah, and they thought Ivy seemed like a good fit.
I've been an animal lover since Yehi, and he's been wanting a dog for years, and we've just decided, now that we have a place that has plenty of room for her, we wanted to get one.
Caitlin and Cameron had been looking into getting a dog for a while, and said that the recent coronavirus didn't really have any impact on their decision to do so.
Basically, since we moved into this place about a month ago, we actually really started looking, because now we have the room and landlord's okayed it. And when we met her, she's just so sweet, so happy.
Ivy's now at home with Caitlin and Cameron, and she seems really happy there. I think it's a good fit for her. As for me, I think I had a little bit of empty nest syndrome because after I dropped Ivy off with Caitlin and Cameron, I went back to the shelter and started fostering a dog named Sweet Betty. They said she's a little bit easier to handle than Ivy, but I guess we'll have to find that out.
The novel coronavirus took the world by storm in early 2020, uprooting people's daily lives and routines. Many students refused to accept their reality, but the security blanket of spring break couldn't last forever. As the severity of the virus overtook colleges, students across the country were forced to live in their new normal of heartache, confusion, and anxiety. Our basic multimedia reporting class from the University of Virginia tried to make sense of the COVID-19 world college students now live in by creating a documentary of our generation's experiences.
Living through COVID-19 has taught me not to take my health and safety for granted.
How to cook. I didn't do much cooking before, and now I've got a lot more time and I still need to eat, so.
It's really important to value just doing the little things in life. And I'm definitely gonna value the time that I can spend with my friends and families, even like acquaintances more.
The importance of the close relationships that we have, when you kind of strip away everything else that's going on in the world and all the other things that we care about and do, all that really matters at the end of the day are those people that you actually have around you.
UVA has really come to be a home, and without it, I feel very empty.
Some people have been a lot more affected by it than others. Some people have acted a lot more responsibly than others.
There are a lot of people up against some really tough situations right now, so I didn't really have that full perspective before.
When I left Charlottesville so soon, it was like losing your best friend without saying your last goodbyes and letting them know how much they meant to you.
I'm just humbled by all of the things that I've learned from my peers.